Malachi chapter 3, I'm going to be teaching this morning the third teaching in a series entitled Partnership. Subject this morning is partners of giving. If you've been with us, I've been teaching about partnership and what we're looking for in people that are aligning with our church called Word and Spirit International Church, which will celebrate its one-year anniversary next Sunday morning. The first teaching I did, I taught about partners of loyalty. Last time I was with you, not last week, but the week before, I talk about partners of service, and today I want to talk about partners of giving. Those are three critical things that I believe anybody that's aligned with the church ought to be involved with, whether it's our church or any church. So if you're watching by television, then you ought to have these same characteristics and traits also in your life as it pertains to your local church. By way of introduction, there was a study conducted by a New York trust company which revealed that one in every 425 people in America are millionaires. And 425 people in America are millionaires. Do you actually believe that it is God's plan for all the millionaires to be humanists, pornography producers, whiskey distillers, tobacco company presidents, rock music promoters, and corporate raiders? It's a rhetorical question. We say no. We believe there ought to be some Christians who are also millionaires. Now, I'm just going to say I believe there are some in potential sitting right here in this place. You got to believe it first before it can happen. See, for whatever reason, we have been sold a bill of goods for too long that it's God's desire for us to have nothing as believers. Where did that come from? What ends up happening is you have all these people that we talked about a moment ago who are rich and blessed and wealthy, and as a result of it, they promote their agenda. How many know it's about time that we had some believers with morals, ethics, and values who also had money that could advance the kingdom of God? The Bible says in Matthew 24, 14, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, meaning ethnic groups, and then the end will come. How many know it takes money to do that? I'm going the first week of August. I've been invited by Roger Clark and his wife, and they've invited me to go to Haiti, and I'm going to go there. I'm going to minister to their pastors in a retreat setting. How many know they need some stuff like refreshing and encouragement, prophetic words, and some teaching? So I will be doing that, but it takes money to get on a jet to fly down to Haiti and do that. In the same way that when we go to Africa, or we go to China, or we go to India, wherever we go, it takes money to go there. And what we do is then we put into the hands of leaders, or in a gospel crusade situation, the gospel, and not only that, but we teach and train and elevate them that they in turn who are enculturated in their culture as leaders can touch their people. And so what happens is we need some money to do that. And I'm not apologizing. I'm embarrassed to ask for that. Come on. You know what? There's a lot of things that people give to, and I'm going to just tell you right now, the greatest thing that anybody can give to is giving to the kingdom of God. Do I hear an amen? Amen. There are three potential sources of income. I'm going to quote my friend Bob Rickey from his book, Financial Champions Arise. There's money streams, how money gets to us. Three primary ways. Number one, it is earned income. That means people at work. How many of you have a job? Let me see your hand. How many of you need a job, would like a job? Let me see your hand. Okay, so Lord, you see the hands of those that need a job or a better job. I call it forth in Jesus' name. Recently, where is he at? Where's our drummer Jason at? Where are you at, Jason? Oh, there he is back there, Jason. We were talking one day, and he says, man, I need a job. I'm starting to rack up some bills. I says, well, let's just agree. And then I heard from Ian that there was a job, some jobs available. And I says, hey, talk to Ian and Lane Forest Products because there's some jobs. He went there, and he got a job. He's producing. God's blessing him. He comes ready, steady Eddie, on Wednesdays. Man, he's ready to slap his tie down. I says, wait a minute. Don't give it to me. Put it in an envelope. Let's do it the right way and do all that. But there's something about him. You all heard Jan Crook a couple of weeks ago when she talked about how we prayed and interceded and God met her with the job that is over at a care center. She's now their head cook, chef, slash whatever. God's blessing her and she has more work that it's coming out her ears. I was talking to Joseph over here. Same thing. Needing a job. We gave directions. Says, hey, go try this place out. He went and checked it out. He ended up getting a job there. They promoted him. Now he's working 60 hours a week, 12-hour days, and he has more than enough and it's coming out of his ears. Now, I got to believe God is no respecter of persons. If he can do it for these people, because I believe there's favor on this house because we believe in tithes and offerings. And not only, listen to me, not only that, but we as a church are a tithing church. I want you to know that when you tithe, it comes in here. And our first 10% is going out into other ministry. We give away from ourselves in tithes. So in earned income is money that's people at work. Secondly, it's investment income. That means money at work. Your money is invested. Now, we could use a little bit better money invested in certain things right now, and because the return on investments oftentimes is not very good. CDs are low, money markets, all those things. But you know what? There is still some money out there to be made. Investment, that's your money working. How many of you know, in order to become really, really wealthy, this is just a sidebar. You can work 60 hours, 65, 80. You still need to, at some point, have your money invested where it's compounding. Because just basically having a job and people at work will not necessarily make you wealthy. What makes you wealthy is your money at work. That you've put some money away, it's invested, it's making. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So I bless that on you. I was talking with somebody yesterday. I was talking about a relative of theirs. And he says, yeah, this relative works for a bank, and they're a loan officer, and they go around talking about investments and talking about money. And they say, you ought to have a $20,000 to $30,000 nest egg somewhere available. I says, praise God, I'm up with that. And it's exactly right. Why? Because God wants to bless you. Now, here's the deal. Oftentimes, there are limiters in Christians' mindset that they get this poverty spirit and mindset. Because I had nothing, my parents had nothing, their parents had nothing, I guess I'm always going to have nothing. You have got to break that off. That has to be broken off you. That is a spirit that needs to be broken off. You need to get rid of a poverty mindset. I had to break it off of me. I don't know about you, but I grew up, I came at times in my life, man, we're having the powdered milk, we're having the government cheese, we're eating cabbage cheese I confused that. That was you and I having cottage, no, we had macaroni and cheese for weeks and then we were in college. But, you know, we had like cabbage, you know, cabbage is okay, but two nights, three nights in a row, man, it gets stinky after a while. Of course, if you're Korean, you know, kimchi's really good. You know, they like it stinkier, the better. I love kimchi, by the way. But my point is this. Then some of you may not. Maybe you have a wealthy background. Great. I'm for you. I bless you. Because sometimes you don't have to work through a negative mindset about money and handling money. Some people were raised in a poverty situation, a welfare situation. And what they feel then is they're doomed to repeat that cycle over and over again. That has to be broken off in Jesus' name. Do I hear an amen? Amen. So there is money that is making money for you. That is money at work. Thirdly, it's gift income. Money given is a gift. People give you a gift. Here's a gift. I want to write you a check. I want to give you a certain amount of money. Today, when I got up, went downstairs because it's Father's Day, right? Helen and I have a little tradition at our house. We always put out cards on the day of birthday or Father's Day. It's usually waiting down there when we come downstairs. We have a breakfast nook, and so it puts it on there. I put hers on there at Thanksgiving, Christmas, Mother's Day. Now, my wife, she's very practical. She does not like flowers. She doesn't like candy. She likes tangible assets. She loves clothes. So what I do for her, I will go and I will buy a card at one of the Macy's or whoever. What are the Macy's? Is it still Macy's or somebody else? Somebody, different places, you know. Ladies, tell me some names of clothing places. Ross, thank you. What else? JCPenney's. We're not shopping there anymore because they went for the gay agenda. But anyway, so what else? I'm not telling you what to do. I'm just telling you what I'm doing. Nordstrom's. Thank you. The Rack. All kinds of places. All right, so you're hearing me. You didn't hear me say that, did you? I'm not. When they take out an agenda, guess what? I have an agenda too. It's the King's agenda.
That's right.
All right, so that's a freebie. Darn, those things get me into trouble sometimes, but it's all right. That's okay. By the way, we love gays. We love people that are of alternative lifestyles. We just want them to come into the freedom that serves in Jesus. Do I hear an amen? So anyway, what happens is, so she will go for clothes. So this last Mother's Day, I said, honey, we're going on Saturday, and we went shopping. And I took her to pick that, and she goes, oh, I'm going to get that one too. So we got this stuff, she brought it home, put it in there. So she got clothes. So my son, he helped me yesterday, or whatever day it was, Friday. Matt's here, and he's much more stylish than I am. So he got me my outfit here. He helped me pick it out. All right? So anyway, I picked the pants, though. But my point is, then I thought that was it. I came downstairs this morning. Here's my card. I opened my card up. I pulled it out. And there's money in the card. Come on, somebody. Yeah. She goes, because, you know, I like to buy stuff like fishing gear and hunting gear and arrows, and she doesn't want me to have that stuff. So she, rather than me, she lets me just go do what I want to do with that. So that's awesome. So that's a gift. A gift. Do you know that we even tithe on gifts? Now let's talk about this quickly. I have two areas of giving this morning I want to talk about, and we don't have a lot of time, but you're going to hang with me till I'm done, right? Number one, we're going to talk about two areas of giving, partners of giving. The first is the tithe. Giving the tithe. Malachi chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. Let's read it. It's one of our texts this morning. It says this. This is the Lord speaking through Malachi the prophet. It says, I, the Lord, do not change. I know he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. We know that, right? Multiple places. So you, descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your ancestors, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. How many of you know it's imperative that we keep God's decrees? There's blessing on keeping his decrees. Read Deuteronomy 28 if you want a lesson in blessing. You want to be blessed when you're going out, coming in, rising up, sitting down. You want to be the head, not the tail, above, not beneath. Then you need to read Deuteronomy 28. There's a key to the blessing. It's doing what the Lord says. He then says, but you ask. He says, but you ask, how are we to return? Will a mere mortal rob God, yet you rob me? Whoa, you're asking me, are you telling me that we're robbing you? You're under a curse, the whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe. Everybody say the whole tithe. I mean, you know, a third is not a whole tithe. I went to a church that I pastored, and I thought this church was just this was a powerhouse of giving. Went to this church, and I found out when I went to the Forest Board meeting, the church was only giving 3%. I says, gentlemen, if you want me to hang around here, we are going to come uppins to a full 10%. Because I will not stand in that pulpit and ask these people to give 1/10 part of the whole, which is biblical, by the way, and this church is not doing that. That's nonsense. We will tithe. Not only were we a tithing church, we were a giving church. Every church that Helen and I have led has been a tithing and giving church. It is our desire to have the blessing of the Lord on the house. That is predicated upon us honoring him by giving the first fruits called the tithe. All right, he goes on to say, bring the whole tithe to the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing, how many of you could take a little of that, that there will not be room enough to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines of your fields will not drop their fruit before it's ripe. How many of you know we don't have vines, we don't have barns, we don't have animals. Is that right? Put it in today's context and culture. Houses, we have cars, we have vehicles. Those things, how many of you know, they can go further and last longer and not go into the shop and not have repair. Your teeth, you don't have to go to the dentist's office. Well, you still need, you know, your every, you know, twice a month, twice a year at least. Twice a month. Wow, you'd have clean teeth. But anyway, twice a year, you know, your cleanups, checkups, and all that, and get your work done. So that what I'm saying is that he says that they'll provide protection, covering for that. Going on. He then says, then all the nations will call you blessed, for years will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. You know, one of the biggest things that ticks me off is whenever you go somewhere and you hear that the church, banks won't loan to churches because basically churches are not a good risk because they've defaulted on what they said they were going to do. That is bad. That is not right. It should not be that way. Churches ought to have a stellar report when it comes to, and people in the church. Look at somebody and say, he's talking about you right now. You have a stellar report. Some of you, it may be by faith right now, okay? Maybe it's not there yet, but I'm speaking by faith and prophetically over you, that you're going to have a stellar credit report because of the blessing of the Lord on you. The Bible says he maketh one rich and he adds no sorrow to it. Come on, somebody. I can take that in Jesus' name. All right. I better get to work. Number one, giving the tithe. Tithe simply means, should be on the screen behind me, 1/10. The Hebrew masir and a tenth part. But the tithe is the first tenth or 10% of your gross income. Keys to financial breakthrough, Dr. Tan, whatever that is, sing, okay? So I'm quoting him. And I agree with that. The first tenth belongs to the Lord. I give off the gross. We always have. We always taught that. We've done that all of our married life coming up on 34 years. We believe the tithe. Basis of tithing. I'm going to give you some quick bullet points about this. Number one, and you get these notes, and if you'll just jot these down, because I may not spend a lot of time on them, but you read them. You meditate on them. Because some people struggle. And, oh, I'll get to it in a minute. I'm getting ahead of myself. All right, bullet point one, before the law. How many of you know that tithing preceded the law? People say, well, you know that tithing stuff, that's just legalism. You ought not to do that because that's legalism. That's the Old Testament. How many of you know the tithe happened before the law was ever given? You ever hear a guy by the name of Abraham? You ever hear by his grandson named Jacob? Before the law ever came into existence, they were tithing. When it says Abraham came back from defeating the kings of Kedi Lamor, it says, and the five kings that were arrayed against him, that he went to Jerusalem, at that time called Salem. And it says that he met with Melchizedek. It says that he went there and he gave him a tenth. How many of you know the lesser always blesses the greater? Are you hearing me? So he gave him 10% of all the spoils that he took in battle. He didn't keep anything. I mean, he kept what he was his, rightfully his. And it says he took and he tithed off of that 10%. He'd won it in battle. Jacob, his grandson, understood the concept of tithing. Remember Genesis 28, he has this vision I talked about earlier. And it says the angels of God ascending and descending in open heaven. Come on, somebody. If it was legal for Jacob, it's legal for us. Are you hearing me? Some of you have been there. Some of you need to go there. Some of you will be going there. I will be going there. But I mean, you can go there and visit now. That's another teaching. So anyway, come on Wednesday nights. I'm talking about the glory. So here's the deal. He has this encounter when he gets done. He says, Lord, if you will keep me and help me through my progress in life, I will give you a tenth of absolutely everything I have. Read it. It's there. I'll give you a tenth, the first fruit, the best. Listen, when Helen and I get our checks, we deposit those checks, the very first check that she writes on our behalf, because we are we, is this, is that she, on our behalf, because we're we. How many of you know husband and wives are one? You're one. All right, what happens is she writes on our behalf. That first check, it goes to Word and Spirit International Church. Why is that? This is our storehouse. This is where we give to. And then when the first things come at the end of the month and we write our first check, guess what? Those first checks are going to those that we are blessing and the different ministries that we're blessing all over this world. Because we're a world-minded church. Are you hearing me, saints? So before the law. Secondly, it was under the law. Leviticus 27:30. And in Malachi, we're reading right here. It was under the law. It was during that time frame that it was before the law and it was during the law. I could take you back to the Garden of Eden. God says, of all the trees you can eat, guess what? There's one. Don't you dare eat from it. The day that you eat from it, you'll surely die. It was reserved for him. It was his 10%. But guess what? Mankind blew it. And so we go down the road of where we go. But he still says, listen, the 10%, the best belongs to me. The best belongs to me. In a lot of houses, especially on Father's Day, today, some of you are going to go barbecue. I almost had a countdown of hamburgers cooking on the grill, but I think I'll save that till next week. Pssh, and you watch the cooking. But let me tell you something. Oftentimes, out of respect to a father, and especially today, if you're barbecuing, the best, juiciest T-bone ought to go to Dad, just the way he likes it. If you're Vern, you wipe its nose and you throw it on the plate. If you're Helen, you have it still semi-bleeding. If it's me, I like it medium. It just depends. But the point is it goes the best. In the same way, come on. Here's the deal. The best goes to the Lord. I have so much to say and not a lot of time to say it. In the Old Testament, when they would make their sacrifices and offerings, they would bring them to the temple. They would throw them in the cauldron, and the priest would stab with a trident whatever came up out of the pot that was his. Because the best went to the Lord. You know what? The fat portion belonged to the God. You know what? The fat is that part that makes your meat juicy. I don't know why I'm down this meat thing. I'm going to start stirring everybody's juices up. But that's what makes it juicy. It belongs to the Lord. It's what flavors it. So it's under the law. Second or third thing is it's after the law. After the law, not only that, but it's in Matthew 23:23. When Jesus is speaking, he says, listen, you give your mint, your cumin, your dill, your spices. He's talking to the Pharisees. He says, you give all of these different spices. He says, you tied down to the... Have you ever gone to your spice rack? Can you imagine this? These guys are so radical about tithing off of their spices that what they do is then they neglect love and mercy and kindness. This is what Jesus... He says, listen, he says, you should not have neglected the former. That means giving the tithe, but you also should love your neighbor as yourself. It's not an either or, it's a both. Everybody say both. We ought to love our neighbor, but we also ought to love God and prove it by our giving the first fruits. Do I hear an amen? Amen. All right. Praise God. I'm preaching better than you're amening right now. So it's after the law. In Hebrews 7, 1 through 10, when the writer writes, he talks about that very thing that took place with Melchizedek. And he says that way back when, what was happening, the priest was foreshadowing that which was come and is in the reality of the now. How many of you know that Jesus is the fulfillment of the type of Melchizedek? No beginning, no end, no father, no mother, no traceable lineage. How many of you know his lineage is rooted in heaven? Do I hear an amen? So there's a type and a fulfillment in Jesus Christ, who is the King of Salem. Jerusalem, and the Jerusalem that'll come down to heaven, which I'll talk about putting in another plug here on this coming Wednesday night, so you don't want to miss it. All right, well, you can get the CD or whatever. So we see then that tithing is for Jesus. He tithed. Did you know that? and we ought to also tithe as well. So the basis of tithing is rooted in the word. Secondly, letter B, it's the purpose of tithing. Why do we tithe anyway? It is an act of our worship. Go to Proverbs. We use this often for our teaching time when we get ready to present an offering. Psalms, Proverbs, chapter 3. You say, well, Pastor, what if I don't have any food? What if I don't have this or I don't have that? You trust God by giving the tithe. All right, Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. Here's what it says. Honor the Lord with your wealth. Note this, with the first fruits, everybody say tithe. Of all your crops, then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine. Now, again, I don't have any crops, and some of you may. I don't. We tried to plant a garden, you know, once when I was a kid. Wasn't really successful. It's pretty ugly, to be quite honest with you. We had discussions about doing it this year. In fact, Helen was all ramped up. We need to grow some of our own veggies. And so I had this big grand. I was going to chew up backyard, half of the backyard, rototill it up and all that. And we'd start planting rows. I was talking to people. I was getting excited. Holly even is back with our kids. She says, oh, Dad, I'll come and help you and this and that. Are we going to do raised beds or hill beds or what all, you know, the mounded beds? Or I says, we got to do the raised beds. Helen wants raised beds. So I had this all going on. She goes, I don't want that. I only want a few plants. I says, well, forget that. So I tore my whole backyard out with the help of some guys around here, and then we put sod in. It looks marvelous, darling. You ought to see it. It's really nice. All right, so let's move on. I don't have any crops is the bottom line, but I do have a job, and the job that I have, what happens, the first fruits then goes into, like I said, the first check goes to the Lord. We deposit. How many of you have accounts? Savings, checking, money markets. How many of you have some investments? So you can, what God says, he says, your barns can be filled. It's a different arena. We're not living in an agrarian society. We're living in an urban center at this point in time. So it's shifted, but the principle is still the same. So we see that it's an act of worship. It represents us. So when I give whatever I give, I'm saying, Lord, I'm giving this. Why? Because it's a representation of me, and I'm worshiping you with my giving. Listen to me. Giving an offering, giving tithes and offerings is an act of worship. Get it in your spirit. Get a revelation of it in your spirit. When you're giving, you give as unto the Lord. Does it come to the storehouse? Yes, but it's going as unto the Lord. It's an admission of ownership. Psalms 24:1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. It all belongs to him. Everybody say, it all belongs to him. Tap somebody and say, it all belongs to him. Punch somebody in the arm and say, it all belongs to him. That's for any sleeping people in our midst, all right? It all belongs to him. Romans 10:9. Here's what Romans 10:9 says. It says that one of the ways that we get born again, that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is, you know what the word means? It means master. Kyrios, it means master. He's Lord over everything. When you came to Christ, you relinquished all rights. It's him. Spirit, soul, body, everything that you have, it's his. He's asked you for a portion. He said back in Malachi, test me in this. It's the only point in the entire Bible that you'll find him asking you to test him in something. It's in giving of tithes. It's really an admission of ownership. It belongs to him. And then finally, it's an acceptance of responsibility. That means that I am here to support the church and its presence, which is our present storehouse. Numbers 18:24, and then Malachi 3:10, which says, bring the whole tithe, not a portion, but all of it, where? To the storehouse. That's the local church that you belong to. If this is your house, then it's here. If you belong somewhere else, it's there. If you're watching by television or by YouTube or whatever, listen, it's the same for you. Whatever your house is, that where you're receiving spiritual food from your church body, that's your storehouse. That's where your tithe belongs. Now, if you want to give an offering over and above that to Word and Spirit Ministries and John Torres TV, we'd gladly receive that. Amen? And go into the nations. All right, the purpose of tithing. Quickly, letter C, the blessings of tithing. How many of you would like some blessings? Malachi 3 says it's an open heaven. He says, I will not shut the heavens. In other words, we don't want a brass heaven, which is a resistant heaven. We want an open heaven where God's money is getting to us. Now listen, I know that God doesn't grow money like ripe cherries on a tree. I understand that. God uses the natural means that is people and jobs and gifts and all those things. I already talked about the money streams, how he gets to it. Some of you need to broaden your horizons regarding money streams. Your money stream has typically been your job. It's my job. Change your thinking. Start calling money in from the east, west, north, and south. Lord, it's coming to me in inheritances. It's coming to me, money that's been tucked away. It's arranged for me. I don't know how it's getting here, but I call forth checks in the mail. Come on, somebody. There are times I go to the mailbox and I'm just believing for checks in the mail. I don't know how they're going to get there, but somebody's sending us money somehow. Oh, Pastor, why do you think that way? Listen, if Jesus told Peter, listen, we're going to pay our taxes and I don't have any really cash on me right now, But I want you to go fishing, Peter, which was your former occupation. You ought to be good at it. I want you to go out and catch a fish, bring the fish back, open its mouth, and there's going to be a gold coin in there. Take it. Pay your taxes and my taxes. If Jesus could do that supernaturally, he can supernaturally take care of you somehow, some way. Do I hear an amen? But you have got to be faithful in giving the first fruits. An open heaven, not brass. Man, I want an open heaven when it comes to finances. The treasuries of heaven released. I say, Lord, dispatch the angels assigned to me to go to the east, west, north, and south and bring money to me in Jesus' name. Strawberry from this morning. Seeds. All right. So, I know you all wanted to know that, but you're going to figure out why I'm up here going like this anyway. So, all right. An acceptance of responsibility. It's to support the church. It's the present storehouse. And then we go down here, open heaven. Blessings of tithing, open heaven. Also, it's spiritual and material blessings. Malachi 3:11. It says this. Look at verse 11 here again. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, so the vines of your fields will not drop their fruit before it is ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed. I want to be called blessed. He then says, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. It will be a delightful land. So here's the deal. Spiritual and material blessing. 3 John 2. Beloved, I would above all things that would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. 3 levels. Yep. Spiritual prosperity, physical prosperity, financial prosperity. See, we try to delegate that away. It says, oh, no, we'll get corrupted if we have money. Listen, money is amoral. It's neither good nor bad. Is that right? It's neither good nor bad. Here, I got $4. Anybody want $4? Come get it.
I ain't shy.
Come get it. Okay, you get that? All right, how much of that belongs to the Lord?
A dime of it.
1 dime, 10%. 1 dime. No, you could keep the other 90. My point is this. Is that God wants to bless you. But 3 John 2 says you have to be willing to be blessed. That means you got to do something. He wants to bless you spiritually, emotionally, and financially. And what I said is oftentimes the church says, well, we're going to keep you poor and humble. Give me a rip and break. I can be humble without being poor. Okay, because I've been poor, and I tell you, sometimes I ain't very humble when I'm poor. So it's an admission of ownership. I mean, that's my other point. Spiritual blessing and material blessing. All right, next point is rewards of labor preserved. In other words, that which you have is not going to be consumed. Okay, everything we have is going to rust and go away. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Moths, rust, they're going to eat, chew up, all those kinds of things. That's going to happen. But what the bottom line is we're investing in the kingdom of God. That's kingdom stuff will last forever. So rewards of labor is preserved. Proverbs 13:22 says that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. I think every daddy in here ought to, because it's Father's Day, you ought to want to leave an inheritance to your kids. Something that, my son's saying, all right, amen, come on. The house, the vehicles, this, that. But that needs to be your mindset. Why? Because our mind needs to be renewed to the Word. See, the problem is we don't always teach the full gospel. And nobody wants to talk about money because it's taboo. Oh, it's taboo. Money, it's sinful. It's not sinful. When Paul said to Timothy, the love of money is the root of all evil. He didn't say money. He says the love of it. It's an inordinate desire. How many of you can have a wrong mindset about anything? That inordinate desire for it is what's wrong. It's the desire to be used as a tool. That's a right desire. So when you can see money simply as a tool, then I believe God will begin to get more to you. If you'll be faithful in what you have now, God will get more to you. Come on, somebody. If you'll take care of what you have now, God will bless you. We're driving old cars. Let's see, older cars. I should say not old cars. Your car is what, about a 2004 model? Mine's like a 1998. But we take care of them. Our house is 17 years old. Have to paint it. I got to mow the lawn. Some people, you might find a car in the backyard because the lawn's so high out there. You mow it once in a while. Oh, Pastor, don't talk about that now. You're going to step on my toes. Oh, speaking of which, shine your shoes once in a while. Wash your clothes every once in a while. Go figure, iron them once in a while. You saw the guy thing on there about the ironing thing earlier? You're meddling. No, I'm telling you truth. I want to bless you. I want to help you. Isn't that what a dad does? Okay. Look at somebody and say, he's preaching really good right now. Come on now. Rewards of labor preserved. And I chopped the notes off on my next one, which is divine protection. Malachi 3:11, Psalms 91. I did a whole series on Psalms 91 about he who abides under the shelter of the Almighty. That whole thing. Protection. Covering. All right? All right, let's go on. Point number two. Ah. Everybody take a deep breath. See, only an hour more. Lewis is getting out of here while the getting's good, I guess. He's cutting out. Oh, praise God. So tithes and offerings, it's foundational. I'm just going to be bold with you. Yeah, I'm giving until you're giving the tithes.
That's right.
Do you know what most waitresses and waitresses get now, what the going rate is for tips right now? Anybody know?
15.
Minimum. 15 to 20. Now, some people sit in a restaurant, unless they're cheapskates, and bless God, don't you leave no stinking track and not a tip. You go into a restaurant, oh, I'm going to bless him with a tip. You knothead. Now, you know I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about somebody watching us viewing. Because I know our people don't do that right. Don't you dare go into a restaurant and say, I'm going to bless him with a track. All you're going to say is you're nothing but a cheap, tight wad. Whatever else you could come up with. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You would not stiff a waitress or a waiter, or you shouldn't. And yet people stiff God all the time. The Empty Tomb did a survey a couple of years ago on tithers that actually tithe. Quote, tithe, because remember what I said, one-tenth part of a whole? It's gone down year after year after year. The average Christian that says they're a Christian, love the Lord, sold out to him, 3%, not 10%. I'm going to tell you something. Empty Tomb did another survey. If all that say they are Christians in the world would tie to their local church, there would be no poverty, there wouldn't be no hunger, there wouldn't be all these needs because it would be met, because God would so have blessed through these different means that the needs would be met. Okay, so tithe is foundational. That's non-negotiable in my book. That's the starting point. Offerings are over and above. 2 Corinthians chapter, see, I'm going to get to the New Testament, but tithing is New Testament. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Say, I still love you, Pastor.
Love you.
Say, I'm still for you, Pastor.
For you.
All right, 2 Corinthians 9. I heard an empty pause there. Sucking all the air out of the room. We had to liven things up a little bit. All right. 2 Corinthians 9, verse number 6. Are you ready? Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, says to them, remember this, and he's writing to us. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. In other words, Jeff, come on, Jeff. I got to plead with you, Jeff. Don't you know, Jeff? You got to give, Jeff. We're going under unless you give, Jeff. The bills aren't going to get paid, Jeff. That is reality. Jeff, please, let me get your wallet. I'll give it for you, Jeff.
Nothing in there.
Jeff's going all the time, no, I don't think so, I don't think so. That's reluctantly or under compulsion. Listen, giving has to be an issue of your heart where you say, Lord, I understand this principle and I love you and I enjoy being a part of what you're doing. Therefore, I can give to it. Freely, volitionally, literally, I was going to tell you in a minute how you're going to give. He then says, for God loves a what? Cheerful giver. Literally in the Greek, hilarious. What do you think of when you think of hilariously?
Hilarious.
Come on. Is it hilarious or hilarious?
Hilarious.
Hilarious. Thank you. Ha! Yeah! Simon! Yeah, I can't wait to give. Jump up and down. You ever see a kid? Yeah, are you all right over there? You ever see a kid when you tell them, we're going to get ice cream?
Yeah.
Oh, man, they get all excited. They're dancing a jig. You say, we're going to take an offering. You ought to get as excited about going down and getting an ice cream cone as you are giving to the Lord. More so. It ought to be a celebration. Man, I can tell you, when I got to go down to KP Drive-In and get a soft serve ice cream, man, I got jacked up. I was excited. We loved it. We'd buzz down there in our bikes. We'd get an ice cream. One time, I digress for a moment, another ice cream story. So John, Mark, Matt, and Helen and I were going to ice cream. Now, she wanted to go to DQ. I wanted to go to Baskin and Robbins. So I compromised. I said, all right, this was on Coburg Road. It was when Baskin Robbins used to be over on Coburg, and then DQ was up there at the corner. So I went in. My favorite, double chocolate almond. Oh, I love, you know how long it's been since I've tasted any ice cream? I've lost 27 pounds, by the way. 27 pounds. So I love double, that's a misnomer. I don't love it, I like it. See, that's the problem with most people. They say they love stuff, they don't have a concept of love. But I really do like it. So I got two scoops. You know how they got the skinny little cones and then they mount it up on top of there? And so I'm licking on that puppy. I get over to Dairy Queen where they're at. And they're going to go get their ice cream. And I'm getting out of the car. And when I get out of the car, guess what happens? I went to take a lip. That whole thing fell off on the ground. I'm like a little kid. I wanted to cry. Give me a break. Second roll, yeah, that's right. Man, no, but that can't compete with that. I mean, come on, what a letdown. So they got theirs and I just kind of pouted. Okay, and talking about giving our money, Paul used the metaphorical figure of sowing and reaping. The analogy is taken from agriculture. But he is not talking about a farmer and his farm. He's talking about the Christian and his giving to God and their kingdom of and the kingdom of God. When we think of giving as sowing, we understand that we should expect, here's the thing, most people don't expect anything back. You got to get your expectation up. It's the principle. Genesis 8:22. As long as the earth endures, is it enduring right now? There's going to be seed time, there's going to be harvest. Dennis planted some filbert trees or had them out there on his property. I've been out there, seen it with my own eyeballs, Dennis and Tony. They have a nice spread out there, out past Ian and Elizabeth. And I got to tell you something. At some point in time, because they've nurtured those trees, they've taken care of those trees, guess what? There's going to be filberts on them to be harvested. They also planted fruit trees down there. And those things also will begin to bear fruit. They've nurtured them. They've watered them. They've fertilized them. They take care of them. At some point, he has an expectation as a farmer that there's going to be, blessed God, at some point in time, fruit on those trees. If we can do that in the natural, because it's the principle of seed time and harvest, it works in every arena of life. If I show myself friendly, how you doing, Mark? So good to see you. Guess what? I'm going to get friendly back. If I show love.
Oh, baby.
If I show love, I'm getting love back. It's reciprocal. Listen here. Yeah, I'm not kissing you, buddy. You got too hairy a beard. Because what happens is, whatever you plant in seed is always multiplied. It comes back more. True. True that. It's a principle. All right. So there you go. When we think of giving a sum, we understand that we should expect increase from our giving, but only in proportion to our giving. Let's go on in the text. Remember, so sowingly, you sow sparingly, you get sparingly. You sow generously, you also reap generously. We give cheerfully. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you'll abound in every good work as it is written. They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower, say, that's me. And bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed. Will, not might. Now I'm reading you the word. This is not John's gospel. This is the word. He says, will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched. Some of your versions will say rich. In what way? A few ways? In every way. Why? So that you can be generous on some occasions, on every occasion, and through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Hallelujah. That when you give, it brings thanksgiving to God. That the blessing that you bestow ultimately brings thanksgiving to God. God is praised because of our giving. All right. Action is sower, plant, or give. The amount is either sparingly or generously. The attitude is either cheerful or reluctantly. The abundance is all that you need will abound. Activity is that then you can be generous on every occasion. Finally, I'm going to wrap this up. The devil wants drug dealers, the alcohol producers, and the pornographers to be rich. He wants false religions to prosper. He takes great pride in seeing the humanists flourish so they can propagate their Christless, crossless philosophy. Satan does not want to see Christians prospering financially because he knows what dedicated Christians do with their money. They keep investing it into God's kingdom. God gives Christians power to obtain wealth in order that he might establish his covenant on the earth. Deuteronomy 8:18, it is the Lord who has given you the ability to get wealth, to establish his covenant among the nations. You see, it takes money to print Bibles, produce gospel radio broadcasts, television programs, and takes teams to the nations. That last sentence was mine. I quoted the rest of it. Isn't that true?
Amen.
When you walk into Albertsons, do you think, all they want is my money?
Yeah.
When you walk into Safeway, do you think, all they want is my money? When you walk into Bi-Mart, do you think all they want is my money? When the U of O sends you an opportunity to come and be a part of their football seats for the season, do you think all they want is my money? When the U of O says, hey, listen, come to Mac Knight, we'll get you a seat here, da-da-da, do you think all they want is your money? When Nike goes in and they want to sell you a pair of tennis shoes for $100 and upwards, do you think all they want is your money? Is that what people think? No, they can't wait to get in there and buy the latest, hottest, newest thing. And then they come to church, oh, all they want is my money. They just want my money. Listen, honestly, God really doesn't need your money, but it's the means that he uses to fund his operation on planet Earth. And there you go. The bottom line is, it is his means to legitimately prosper you and bless you. Now you can say, Pastor, you're all out to lunch. I'll still love you. But I got to teach the word. And I'm looking for partners around here who will join us.
Amen.
Giving tithes. That's to the storehouse. That just runs the place. All the things that we're doing. We've been running on a limited basis since our transition. We're into the promised land.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? And we will incur a lot more expense as we move into our next phase. I call that forth in Jesus' name. This whole thing coming together. By the way, our chairs will be here the first week of July. Our brand new chairs. I would have liked them to be here for the anniversary, but we're going to miss it, so rats. But hey, come the next week. That's how I'm going to get you here, the new chairs. No, just kidding. God's word works. I've seen it work in every country of the world. People say, don't teach us in India, it won't work there. Don't teach it down in the jungles of South America, it won't work there. Don't teach it impoverished here, there. It works. The word works. It either does or doesn't. We might as well pack it if it doesn't work. It works everywhere. The word works. People say, well, how can God, a good God, allow those kids to starve in Africa? I'm telling you, God ain't allowing that. I mean, he is allowing it, but he ain't doing it. When you have leaders that allow the enemy to come in and literally have witch doctors and everything else to do what they do, and then when we had certain things where it would pile up on docks and it was never getting it because of corrupt governments. I go on and on. Don't give me that garbage about God. How could he do this? God loves people. He loves them.
Amen.
But he allows people because of man's fallenness and bad decisions for things to operate. He will not intervene unless he's invited to intervene.